Hey folks, gonna do a little video on this GE Monitor Top Type CA float chamber. This came off of a Form B CA. This tall part right here is a kind of a reservoir for non-condensable gas to collect in. And you know, obviously that's your charging port, also where you purge out the non-condensable gases. Now these have a history of the needle valve wearing out, so that even though this is empty of liquid, it'll still flow through here. And this is your metering device on your refrigerant system, so if this never closes off or never throttles back and regulates, it causes the uncondensed vapor to just circulate through the system constantly. So you'd hear the evaporator making a percolating noise or a blowing noise, but it would not really not frost. It might get cool, but it wouldn't frost. So I've been trying to figure out a way to repair this so that it would operate again as it did originally. And I made a test with one where I did that, and it has been working very successfully. So I figure it's time to try to do one on camera and share the technique. And it's probably something others can improve upon or adapt to, using their own materials. But I'm going to do it the way I did the one I've got running right now. So this is the test unit. You can see that cap up there. That's the top of that float chamber. And it has a repair up there. I'm trying to get some light on it with a flashlight, but it's proving difficult. But right in there, you see the bottom of the float chamber hanging down. You can see that there's a coupling on it soldered on. And that's where I had repaired it. And that's what we're going to do on that other float. You see we've got pretty good coating of ice. And you hear there's no rushing or blowing noise in there. And with the unit shut off, you hear no bypassing in the float. So as far as I can tell, it's perfectly healthy. And even in a warm room, it has a really low duty cycle. There's no heat I can detect now because it's been off for a little while, but it seems to be as healthy as I've ever seen a CA. So I'm gonna mount this in the vise to simulate it being installed in the machine, but this is gonna be sideways, laying like this. Because if you were to do this, you would take the top off the cabinet and lay it sideways. So we're going to simulate that, and by putting that in the vise. Try not to drop it on the floor. Okay, got it in the vise. Now, the one that I showed you a minute ago that's running, I did not cut this line. I only cut it here, and then I bent this to the side to work on it. That made it more difficult. And for this demonstration, I'm going to, work like that. This is still connected to the evaporator, and we're going to pick a point down here and cut it. So first thing I'm going to do is clean it perfectly clean with sandpaper, because I want to be sure that when we go to solder it back, we're going to have a good solder joint, and we're not going to have to do sanding with it open and risk getting abrasive inside the system. So I'm going to doctor up this line with sandpaper, and that way, in our pretend fridge, when we go back together with it, it will be easy to solder. I'm gonna do the same thing here, where the needle valve is. Of course, you could use whatever method you wanted to clean it up. I just happen to have this sandpaper in front of me, so I'm using it. Now this float chamber came from another collector, an offline collector. He's not on Facebook or the forum or anything like that, although I wish he were. And he had saved that CA compressor motor that I took apart and used for my increasing the starting torque demonstration. And this was probably part of that machine that motor came from. So that's all cleaned up now, and we'll be ready to cut that. So to prove a repair, we need to demonstrate an improvement over what we started with. So what I'm going to do is use the air hose and I'm going to inject air into this float chamber. And this is the outlet down here. So this is empty of liquids of any type. So air, which is a gas, going into it should be blocked. So if air comes through here, then the float is bypassing. You can hear that, it's bypassing. So if I can stop that from happening, then the fix is a success. Now, if I turn this over, where it's upside down, the float should be all the way open all the time. So like this, it should flow without any problem. See, now it flows more freely because the float's open, but the other way, it should have not flowed any. So now that the problem is demonstrated, let's go about fixing it. We have some really good technicians and engineers on the GE Monitor Top forum that have come up with ways to work on these things, including with the methyl formate units to work on it with it charged. The methyl formate is a liquid under normal conditions, standard conditions, so you can actually open the system up with it charged and not lose your refrigerant. And that's how I did the other repair. So I will put a link in the video description to a thread on our forum where that the method and the conditions have to be met to do the work charged are done. So I'm not going to go into that, but you're going to come up approximately 3/4 of an inch on this tube stem and cut it. And again, this could be done under the right conditions with the unit charged and a little bit of nitrogen put in there to kind of break the vacuum, so to speak. And I'm just going to use a tubing cutter. Doesn't really matter how far down you go, but this is brazed down in here. You don't want to get down in there too far, or you might make a cut and not be able to separate it. So I went up where I'm sure that I've got enough room that it's going to be just hollow space right there where I'm cutting. And you want to use a good sharp tube cutter, not one that's all gapped up, because you're going to have to put this back together. It needs to sit correctly. Okay, now it's separated. And this one has this little tube in it, which is a bypass line for non-condensable gases. So we're going to want to leave that and try to do this job without destroying this. And I'm going to cut the video and try to get a picture of what the float seat looks like down inside there. So again, this little, what looks like wire, that's actually tubing. And I don't want to plug it, so I'm going to put this tape over the end of it. And that sits in there up in this headspace above the float. And it actually lets a tiny little flow of gas go through there so that any non-condensable gas goes through. But it's such a tiny tube, you won't feel the air like I was showing earlier. You won't hear that. So we definitely still have a problem. I've tried to look at this deal up close, and I don't know if the camera is going to focus on it to see the eroded seat. I'm going to try to do a couple more ways to show that, and if not, I'll have to insert a still picture. Okay, so the float seat is right down in there. I don't know how well you can see the eroded condition of it. This is not the worst one I've seen, I'll put it that way. But that is what we're going to attempt to repair, that little orifice you see. Okay, so I've got this set of Harbor Freight diamond abrasive grinding points. They're really made for a die grinder, but we're going to use it in the drill because we want to go slowly. This little kind of rounded taper one, this is the one that I found works beautifully for the seat cutting. And it will pilot itself on this part up here and not have wobble, and then you don't have to worry about getting it at an angle. And then you can see the little cutter goes right down in there to cut the seat. So that will renew the damaged surface. Okay, I have that grinding point in the drill, and I'm going to come down in there just like I showed onto that seat. And that should have recut a new wear surface on there. You can probably see a little bit of a shiny spot now on the video there. Okay, so there's our new seat. I finally got a good angle to show it at. But you can see that we got a good round tapered seat now for the float needle to sit on. Now the next part we have to worry about, that's the actual needle right there. And those typically don't wear. I think it's made of some kind of hard steel. But the issue is, now that we've ground that seat deeper, this is too short. Now, the float only has a little bit of movement to lift the needle up. So we have to be sure that when this part goes back in there, it actually pushes the float upward and lifts it off the bottom of the chamber. Because when it does that, that's what's giving it some force downward in order to seal that. So I'm going to work this this wire back up in here. I know it will go in there like that. And then put the needle back in there. Now, it's fully closed up, but yet the float is not being lifted. So right now, it wouldn't work right. So in order for this to be correct, we have to shorten either this tube or this one. And I believe, like I did on my last one of these that worked, I cut off a piece of this one. So I'm going to put this back in the vise and use the tubing cutter and cut a small ring out of that in order to shorten the whole assembly and allow it to seal off. So I'm going to try to take the minimum bite that this tubing cutter can take and still work right. Sometimes it won't want to track in its own groove if it is taking too small of a bite. So I'm going to have to go off camera where I can get my face right up in that and see what I'm doing a little better. But I'm going to take off probably an eighth of an inch. All right, I got it started good where it's actually cutting a nice straight cut. Try to go carefully with it because, again, I don't want to make a mess. Have to start filing on it, doing that kind of thing, and making shavings. The goal is to, you know, we're pretending to work on a complete system here where I don't have the luxury of blowing it out with solvent or anything, so any dirt that I get in there is going to be harmful. That sounded like it's almost cut off. There we go. Got a little ring there if you got a very small finger. So now we have this sticking down a little further. Not all of them have that little tiny tube on there. That's kind of was GE's attempt at fixing the non-condensable gas issue. You see now I'm pushing the float up when I push that in there. If I hold it all the way closed, there's still movement of the float, so I haven't gone too far. What I'm going to do is take some measurements to see just how far that moves. Okay, so I've got a shortened coupling, all deburred and clean. It'll fit over that for soldering. And then I've made this little shim here. That's going to set the amount of preload pushing the float upward. And I took those measurements I mentioned earlier, and I don't see where I wrote them down. Here we go. It looks like there is 78 thousandths of total float movement, and that is counting a factor for free play in the system, where the maximum the float can lift the needle by pulling it up is 78 thousandths. Now, when I cut this off, I cut too much off, and this is actually also about 77 thousandths. So for this to work, I'm going to have to put a shim in there. So I got this little 30 thousandth shim. Put that over that. Now, when I slide this on there, I ought to have about another 30 thousandths of lift on the float when this pushes in. So I'm going to make a test here with it upright, where gravity is going to pull the float down. That way I can actually feel what's happening if I can get this together. A little tube is very fiddly, And all these still had non-condensable gas problems even with it, so I don't know how much good it did. But GE put it there, so I'll put it back. Okay, so with that together, I have just a little bit of, you know, push up on the float or preload. And that's the way I want it, so we're going to go with that. All right, the ring is in place, everything is pushed in, and I've got the vice grips on there keeping the position. So now I'm going to put some flux on the coupler, a little short coupler. I'm trying to be real careful that I don't put too much, because I don't want the solder to go inside and fill in anything in there. So I'm going to be very judicious and conservative with the solder. I want to be sure there's just enough flux for it to be able to take a solder bond. Now I'm going to use this Stay-Brite. Float in there. Oh, made a mess. Well, let that cool off and take a look at it. Not my best soldering job, I hate to say. Okay, so I've taped a blower in there best I can. So I got it in the normal operating position. It should be closed. I put some pressure, and I flip it over, and the float opens. Closed. Open. So now if this were for real, I would, of course, pressure check that solder, because I'm not too happy with that. But again, I was just trying to demonstrate how it's possible to recut that little float seat in there, not have to give up on the functionality of the original design. So what's here on the counter now is everything that I used to fix the float chamber. Tubing cutter, solder, sandpaper, and this little grinding point kit, plus the soldering torch. Now, if you were doing this on a charged methyl formate monitor top, you'd also need nitrogen and the rest of the hermetic service kit and things like that. But just to fix this float seat, nothing special, no exotic tools used at all. Just all basic shop stuff. So anyway, I hope y'all have enjoyed seeing how I fixed that other float chamber and got the unit working like it should. And that one's been running for quite a while now with no problems. I'm really pleased with it, and hopefully this will encourage someone else to do the same thing. Thanks for watching.